Thank you very much. You can hear my voice. I made the effort of catching a cold to get the right voice for this afternoon. I hope you enjoy it. The times of the pseudonym are over. Mostly I'm now writing under my own name. That was only once, I think. I'm going to read a little introduction. It's about 5 to 6 minutes long. And then Nikesh is going to read his essay, Namaste, from the book, and then we discuss. There was an unclouded fountain, we read in Ovid's Metamorphoses, with silver-bright water, which neither shepherds nor goats nor other flocks touched, that no animal or bird disturbed, not even a branch falling from a tree. Grass was around it and a grove of trees that prevented the sun from warming the place. Here the boy, tired by the heat and his enthusiasm for the chase, lies down, drawn to it by its look and by the fountain. While he desires to quench his thirst, a different thirst is created. While he drinks, he is seized by the vision of his reflected form. But, explains Leon Battista Alberti, 1435, in his book De Pictura, Narcissus didn't know that he saw his reflection, and he did not see himself, not to begin with. Only later he understood that he was the one he could see in the pool, along with all the other things, the sky, the trees, the world about him. And maybe that was what made him so happy. He had thought he was alone, looking at a world that was separate from him, a world of other things. And then, all of a sudden, he sees that he is in that world. He is real. In Bernardine Evaristo's novel Lara, she writes about Lara, I searched but could not find myself, not on the screen, billboards, books, magazines, and first and last, not in the mirror. And a little bit later, I longed for an image, a story, to speak me, describe me, birth me whole. Narcissus only loves himself, becomes himself, after he has seen his likeness in the world. To create identity, you need to measure yourself against reflections of yourself, be it in a mirror or in books, because books can be mirrors too, of course. Children's laureate Mallory Blackman told Sky News in 2014 that non-white readers might feel excluded from society if they're not represented in literature. I think, she said, there is a very significant message that goes out when you cannot see yourself at all in the books you are reading. I think it is saying, well, you may be here, but do you really belong? Nikesh Shukla, if you look up his name in the International Movie Database, I did, it says, apparently we don't have any biography for Nikesh Shukla yet. Be the first to contribute. Okay. He was born in England. Google gives no birth date, but knows he is a third generation Indian whose father was born in Mombasa, his mother in Aden, his grandma worked in a battery factory in Keighley, West Yorkshire, and wore a sari underneath her boiler suit. Nikesh grew up in London, in a London suburb that was becoming increasingly Gujarati, while going to a mostly white school. He was deeply in love with Peter Parker, alias Spider-Man, and so our guest about himself, I grew up in a sexist household where my mother, the matriarch, after a full day's work, would be left to cook for the family while I pretended to do my homework and wrote rap lyrics. My sister pretended to do her homework and watched television quietly in mom's room. And my dad sat in a corner of the room drinking and thinking about business. Deep down in Google land, you find an 11 years old entry that says about our guest, Nikesh Shukla, otherwise known as Yamboy, is a solo and collaborative rap artist from Northwest London. His work has been showcased on BBC Two, Radios 1 and 4, and he has performed at numerous festivals. His first solo album, Gujarati Jamboy, came out in 2004 to great critical acclaim. He also, and this comes as a kind of afterthought, writes performance poetry and prose fiction. Nikesh's preferences seem to have changed in the course of the last 10 years. His first novel, The Coconut Unlimited, appeared in 2010 and was shortlisted for the Costa First Novel Award. It is, of course, about teenage rappers who are trying to forge their identity through music. Meat Space, his second novel, which means the physical world as opposed to cyberspace, is, according to The Guardian, an anarchic, self-involved, and admirable, honest portrait of a bookish life lived in the brave new digital world. To promote his new book, the author decided to take things literally and send a piece of meat into suborbital space. Attached to a fork hanging from a weather balloon, the tandoori lamb chop ascended from a field in the Cotswolds at 325 meters a minute for just over an hour and a half before the balloon burst at around 25,000 meters. Nikesh Shukla is also the editor of Rive magazine, and his novel, The One Who Wrote Destiny, is due to appear in 2018. The Good Immigrant, which appeared before the Brexit votum, brings together 21 British black ethnic minority people, writers, poets, journalists, and artists to, in Shukla's words, tell their own stories in their own voices. Each essay explores the subject of race and immigration through the lens of first-hand experience and shares with it a sense of displacement and loss, of never quite being accepted or belonging, of trying to find a space to be in a world that doesn't seem to understand your point of view, and more importantly, accept your point of difference. There was England, Zadie Smith wrote in her novel White Teeth, a gigantic mirror, and there was Irie, without reflection, a stranger in a stranger land, who finds no mirror image of herself in England or its art. Nikesh Shukla's book, The Good Immigrant, tries to color this invisibility and gives a platform to writers of color to tell their stories, stories that show them not as fetishized, romanticized views of a stereotype, but as being real, so that no one of color ever again needs to cry out, I searched but could not find myself, not on the screen, billboards, books, magazines, and first and last, not in the mirror. Thank you.
Thank you for such an illustrious introduction. I think you've caught me out in a lie. I don't remember anyone saying anything nice about my rap EP in 2004. I remember it being described as either a car crash or a work of genius. And it was probably more of a car crash. But yeah.
I mean, this is quite a subject because in Coconut Unlimited, you describe how you came to rap and how rap meant everything to you. And rap was the music you defined yourself with. But rap, actually, I always had the feeling it's more the American side that fascinated you, was it?
I think it was just that at that age, I was growing up in a suburb. My parents we led this sort of quite strange, but I think quite typical for that time immigrant life, where my mum and dad worked 7 days a week, and they could send me to private school for a couple of years, and my sister they couldn't afford to send her, so she went to a state school and now earns a lot more money than me because she chose not to do such a frivolous thing as write. And I never felt comfortable at that school, and I was trying to find my feet. And you need heroes at that time, and I found my heroes in Chuck D and conscious rap. And for me, they felt closer to the identity I was trying to carve out than Pat Sharp, who is like a children's TV. I can't think of anyone.
It reminded me very much of Rich Cohen. Do you know his work? He wrote a non-fiction book called Tough Jews, and it's about Jews in the 50s in America who were fed up with this image of the Jews as being only victims. So they identified with mafia killers. The mafia in New York had a gang of Jewish killers, and they all had very strange names, and the young boys in the 50s in New York all identified with these killers because they were so powerful figures. Mm. And so you felt a similar need.
Yeah, I think so. And I've been hanging around boxing clubs recently. I've been starting to take up boxing, and I've seeing what boxing clubs do for communities is actually for young boys in communities who are trying to find a path, or you know, there's lots of different influences, and boxing clubs offer them like a line of discipline and something that is you know, while it's about power and being able to hit really hard, it's also about strategy and developing your mind as well as your body. And you see all these role models like around the gym, and I sort of feel like maybe I should have hung out in a boxing gym when I was a teenager rather than listen to like gangster rap, which I can't listen to anymore because it was just I'm not that person, and I can't align myself with some of the content.
Boxing is, of course, another way of getting an identity. I was thinking of the Fight Club with Chuck Palahniuk.
Yeah.
But I thought we start with the reading. You read first from Namaste. You read Namaste, and then we continue talking.
Yes. Yeah. Sorry, I just needed to put the records straight about my rap EP.
You can do a rap if you want.
Okay, yeah, I am going to read from The Good Immigrant an essay I wrote called Namaste. Namaste means hello. Namaste means I'm bowing to you. It's a customary greeting, a respectful salutation. It's become a bastardized metaphor for spiritualism. It's white people doing yoga, throwing up prayer hands, chanting Om and saying Namaste like their third eyes are being opened and they can peer directly into the nucleus of spirituality. You need to know this. Because of your skin tone, people will ask you where you're from. If you tell them Bristol, they'll say, no, where are your parents from? And when they know that you're half Indian, one person will always try and impress their knowledge of your culture onto you. I can't sleep. It's 2 a.m. and a party is raging across the road. The flat is rented out to students on a regular basis. Your mother is sensibly sleeping with earplugs in. I can hear you purring in the next room. I know that in 4 hours' time, I have to drive you to London to take you to see your dada and your foy and your fua, to spend time with the Indian part of your family, to say namaste to your Indian cousins, aunties and uncles. I'm driving, so I need the sleep. It transpires that the reason the party is so loud is because someone on the top floor of the house is leaning out of his window, smoking and bellowing a conversation down to someone at street level, which, due to the peculiarities of the houses we live opposite, is about 4 stories worth of shouting at 2 a.m. This is silly, I think. It's Friday night, sure, but it's a residential street. I may have been these kids once, but now I'm a man of my 30s. I'm a man of family now. I'm a man of red wine and Netflix. I'm a man of nights in and community cohesion. I get it. I get what life's about. It's about living like your actions affect the people you don't know as well as the people you do. I've done questionable shit in my youth. But I shouldn't have left detritus for poor working souls to have to clean up the morning after, shout scream songs at the top of my voice, running down streets where families lived, been oblivious to the rest of the world, carrying on like there's something out there for me to interact with. Your mother reminds me of this the next morning when I tell her what happens next. I tell her that I don't want to live with the thought that I'm intolerant of other people's intolerance. I walk out of the house just as the conversation, bellowed across four stories, wraps up and the man on street level leaves to the sound of his friend hoping he gets home safely. I approach the steps up to their stoop. I notice in the shadows a boy and a girl are sitting in the doorway of the main door ajar, smoking. "Excuse me," I ask, "do you mind continuing your party inside?" "Jah bless," the girl in the doorway says. "Namaste," she says again. I repeat myself. I change the words to become clearer, more forceful. "Can you please continue your party inside?" "Namaste," she says again. I hear the boys stifle a laugh. They both say, "Namaste, namaste, namaste," as I try to talk till I'm drowned out. I'm standing under a street lamp wearing my white bedtime kurta and lenga pajamas. My skin is bleached out by the fluorescence of the yellow lamp. There's probably no way they can tell I'm Indian from the lighting, so it's dickery for dickery's sake. The bellowing man leaning out of his window asks if the music's too loud. I look up to him, the voice of reason, and I say again, "Can you please continue your party inside?" "Namaste, namaste, 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 namaste," the girl says. I shout something wounded, passive-aggressive. I go back inside and I lie in bed staring at the ceiling, watching the arrows of passing car headlights pierce cracks in the curtains. Eventually the party quietens. My mind doesn't. I'm rolling in a quagmire of ways to deal with this slight. Beyond writing "Namaste, dickheads" on a placard and placing it in my bedroom window, I don't know what to do. The house residents go home for the summer, having moved in and warmed the house to celebrate. Any calls for an apology I ask for come the autumn will be muted a month too late. I walk past an art centre that's part bar club, part sustainable restaurant, part hot desking for freelance artists, and part dance studio. They host morning raves and yoga classes there. This is Bristol, not Berlin, by the way. I know it sounds very familiar. Most mornings, the steps are daubed with hippies wearing Om and Ganesha parachute pants, their hair in dreadlocks. Bindis mark out the third eyes in the middle of their foreheads. They tie their dogs up to the bicycle racks using scratchy sari material, and they enter the yoga studios to be Nataraja and Ashtanga geniuses, then salute the sun and greet and say goodbye to each other with a solid, heartfelt namaste. "Namaste," one of them says to me one morning as I walk down the road, listening to Jay Paul, swinging my two-tier tiffin up and down. She offers me prayer hands as I pass. I take my headphones off. "Namaste," she says. I grimace. "Hi," I reply. "Namaste," she says. And she raises her prayer hands to touch her bowing forehead. She has faded henna on her fingers. "It just means hello," I say. She looks at me confused. "Namaste, it just means hello. That's it. Namaste," she says again, and I walk on. I have three voices. I realise this when Nerm and his wife come to visit. You're inside your mother's stomach. Your involvement in this story comes just after your mother tells Nerm and his wife that she is pregnant. We're expecting. In his excitement, the typically expressive Nerm gestures wildly with his hands and knocks his pint of lager all over your mum's stomach, all over you. It's funny, but it's not. The way Nerm and I interact is an intersection of our Gujarati upbringing, our East London socialisation, and acknowledgement that there's a white person in the room who needs to keep up. "Yes, bruv, we talk like Goras be listening, innit? Fut our fut, we wipe away pint spill mite, while Katie gets fresh again. We call each other bevakoofs. We cuss out each other's pronunciation, bruv. We greet with the kemcho mite. We're cursive, glottal-stopping, syllable-swapping, rhythmic beasts of anarchic remixed English. Talking to him for the 3 hours he and his wife are in town, I feel like I'm with my peoples again. When I go home, it takes me a while to get my voice back. It's an effort to type this way, in a way that's palatable to Westerners, in a way that's markedly different from my speaking voice, because my speaking voice holds rhythms that weren't made in the West. My mum had three voices. She had her white people phone voice, her Gujlish talk at home voice, and her relative's voice. I have three voices as well. I talk in Gujlish, my normal voice, and white literary party. I don't know whether my normal voice, where I feel most comfortable, most safe, even feels like me anymore. I've splintered into personas. This is the trick of living publicly online with increasing watch and scrutiny. When I first started out on Twitter, I had 10 odd followers, all people I knew in the real world, people I could be myself with. As my following increased, I had to become less of myself and more of the public perception of me as the writer. And it made me lose track of who I was and what voice I spoke in. Nowadays, I ensure that whenever I tweet about literary things, I add the odd fam, bruv, cuz, or innit, just to ensure the execution of my thought or praise comes with the necessary rooting to where I'm from. I'm a hip-hop fan, and much as I agree that it's not where you're from, it's where you're at, actually, it's where you're from. An agent who has rejected me twice tweets about an impending apocalypse because his intern referred to clothes as garms. This sends me into a shame spiral. I've been using this word in two of my three voices since 1994. I replied to his tweet saying, slang's more important than proper English, fam. No one talks in proper English, innit? He doesn't reply. I delete my tweet. I know he's still smarting from a time from when I pulled him up on a snarky tweet about diversity in publishing and his ennui towards it. His response was to say that there was a debate of merit worth having. I told him that it wasn't a debate for me. It was my life. I can't change my skin tone. White people can debate it, but we have to live it. My conversation with Nirm makes me feel lonely. I watch you in your mum's belly squirming about, experimenting with spatial awareness, waking up as she and I settle down to bed after the pub. I wonder what voice you'll have, who you'll be, what you'll sound like, whether you'll have Gujarati reference points, or if the extent of your lingual heritage will only be a solid, heartfelt namaste. I knock on my neighbour's door. I know someone is home because a window at the top of the house is cracked open. I can just about make out the Keep Calm and Carry On poster. I think about my opening line. I don't know whether to be angry or polite or firm or just treat it like it's a joke, like we're all friends here. Like, I know you guys were just dicking around, but you know, words have impact. Or whether I should tell him how I feel. One of the many online arguments I've had about the importance of language, how language can hurt, has been about tea. Chai means tea. Chai tea means tea tea. The number of times you see this on a menu makes you wonder why people can't be bothered to do their research. Like naan bread as well. Bread, bread. A comedian, Kumail Nanjiani, an avid gamer, once expressed his delight that the Call of Duty series finally set a level in Karachi, the city of his childhood, now one of the top 10 most dangerous cities in the world. He was appalled on playing the game to see that all the street signs were in Arabic, not Urdu. He talks about the effort put into making each follicle on each soldier's head stand out, into making their bootlaces bounce as they run, the millions spent developing this game, and how at no point did anyone decide to Google the language of Pakistan. In Jurassic Park, they refer to Pachycephalosaurus dinosaurs as Pakis. The Pakis are escaping, one of the techs exclaims. The budget for the movie was $150 million. I looked it up on the International Movie Database. If I had to place a value on how much people would have to pay me in order to call me a Paki to my face, it would be more than $150 million. Words matter. Words are important. The casualness with which someone I'm working with refers to two coloured girls. The casualness with which a person having her photo taken with a nice view and me obscuring the corner of it asks her husband to ensure he gets one without the Indian in it. The casualness of being on the last train home from London to Bristol in the same car as the bar, listening to two drunk men in their early 20s shout at each other, N-word, we made it, N-word, we made it. They're white, by the way. I didn't mention that in the book. I probably should have done that. Would have made this joke land a bit better. Repeatedly with excruciating enthusiasm. They're just quoting rap, someone might think. They're drunk, they're harmless, they're just being exuberant, dickish but exuberant. But language is important. Years before, I sat in an Indian restaurant around the corner called Oh, Calcutta. I found the exclamation marks both very alarming. The place was owned by a white guy, As I sat with my best friend and his then girlfriend staring at the disco lights, I listened to Kula Shaker sing about Govinda Jaya Jaya, Gopala Jaya Jaya. I read the menu. One of the dishes listed was chicken chuddy, described as an exotic blend of authentic spices, tomatoes, and peppers. It sounded so generic. What was an exotic blend? What are authentic spices? Also, tomato and pepper. Is that it? These are the biggest tastemakers in your dish, apart from chicken. What is chicken chuddy? Also, as you know, chuddy means pants. I told my friend and his then girlfriend. They laughed at the whiteness of it all. Ah, ha, 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 they said. Cultural misappropriation is hilarious, they said. I felt mortified for the owner. He'd probably been duped by some guy who'd asked for a word that sounded Eastern. Maybe the chef was having a joke with him. Maybe he was having a joke with his clients, like, chuddies, guys. I looked around. Everyone in the restaurant was white. It was a hipster student paradise. The mix of Cod Eastern Britpop, minimal red lighting like a moody Ryan Gosling film, and the prices. It felt like puppetry of food. The biggest crime. Not only was the Western Balti curry, made in Birmingham, by the way, synonymous with my country's cuisine, but now we had white guys aping the food we made to fit in with them. I called the manager over. "The chicken chuddy," I said. "You know that chuddy means pants, don't you?" "Ah, ha, 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 ha," he said. "You're having me on, right? It's a specific blend of authentic spices. Nice try." "It means pants," I said. He smiled, itching to get away, and I let him. But language is important. The door opens. He stands in front of me, a boy, not yet 20, wearing a T-shirt that says geek on it. He holds a controller for a games console in one hand and a cider in the other. "Hello," he says politely, nervously. "Namaste," I say, pressing my hands together in prayer. A car a street away pumps out a Bangra loop. The subwoofer bounces around my eardrum. I shake my head, turn around and head back across the street. Usually when I leave for work, you're in the window, waving, propped up by your mum. Your smile is free. It doesn't know nuance yet. We should try and keep it that way.
Thank you so much. Great. I've splintered into personas. I have three voices. Which one are you using right now?
I don't know, man. I had a
white literary party.
I guess so. Yeah. Mean, we are being live streamed on the internet. I had a really interesting conversation with my friend Saskia last night. Who's she's an American who lived in London, and she moved to Berlin 3 years ago. And she was talking about we were talking about this very thing about code switching, about how you have different voices for different environments. And she said that while she's learning to speak German, she hasn't learned German facial expressions, or she hasn't learned how to communicate things with her face, or she hasn't learned how to communicate with her face while she's speaking German. So she talks quite flatly when she's talking German. I thought that was a really interesting thing about personas and about the different voices and the things that we do with our faces as well as the things we do with...
And is it a conscious choice? I mean, do you really think for a moment which language would be appropriate right now?
Yeah, I think... probably more in environments where I feel intimidated, I will switch into the. I will probably mirror the people in my environment and sort of be that persona. But it's. I think it's.
And do you change registers in between?
I don't know. Yeah, but it's not. I don't think it's conscious.
Yeah.
And the thing is, the thing that it took me years to realize about then, the thing about code switching, I think is really interesting, is. you're never a diminished part of yourself. You're just you. It's still you. I mean, we may hide certain aspects or traits or reference points in certain environments, but we all do that, and it doesn't mean that I'm being any less of myself. And it took me years to realize that.
Mm-hmm. Let's stick to language. Quite a few years ago, I translated a novel that starts with a sentence, "My name is Karim Amir, and I'm an Englishman born and bred."
Almost.
Almost.
That
exactly.
Almost. That almost
is the word we're talking about.
That almost killed me. I remember that is probably one of the most important books that I've ever read.
Because of that one word.
Because of that one word. And because of finding that book. So my mum was really adamant about how much TV we watched, which was not very much, but every week without fail she took us to the library, which my sister hated but I loved, and I could read whatever I wanted, and that library had heaps and heaps and heaps of Star Wars and Star Trek tie-in novels. Wow. And I just raced through them, and that was my childhood. And then when I was a teenager, there was a TV series that was about to be on called The Buddha of Suburbia, and it had a brown guy in it, and I'm not gonna lie, it looked like it had sex in it. And I thought, there's no way that my mum is gonna let me watch this. Mm-hmm. And then it said, like at the end of the trailer for it said it was based on a book, and I was like, wow, I can read the sex in the book. She can't stop me doing that. And so I found it in the library. Okay. And I read that first sentence in the library, and I really remember that first line, that word, almost. Because I hadn't ever really experienced anyone or read anything or seen anything where someone debated this idea of dual heritage or what constitutes an Englishman or what constitutes someone who's British or...
Do you remember times when you called your parents because there was a brown person on TV?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. And it was usually I can't remember, it was either Saturday or Sunday morning on BBC Two. There was a show called Network East, which used to show lots and lots of tell lots of stories from the South Asian diaspora in the UK, and we would all watch it religiously. And then if there was a brown person on like a quiz show or something, we'd all watch it together, and it was a really communal time. And in the book, Wei Ming Kam like tells the same story but from the Chinese perspective, and it was really a thing. Like, we were so underrepresented that any opportunity to sort of see a version of ourselves, we snapped on it. And I really remember some of my happiest memories are the times that my family all came together was to watch Desmond's, which was a black British sitcom about a barbershop in Peckham, because that, to my parents, that immigrant experience felt like the closest thing to what their immigration story that they had to watch on TV, and so we would all watch it together. And then, like, The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Like, these were our communal times as a family. Right. And that was the closest thing we had. It was really interesting sort of looking back on that time.
I forgot the year in which The Buddha of Suburbia was published, but it is some years back. The 90s? 19. It must have been earlier.
Yeah. 1990. Okay. I didn't read it until about 95, 96, whenever the TV show was coming on.
And
I think I read it.
Somehow belongs to that wave that Salman Rushdie described in his essay, The Empire Writes Back, which is this summer, 35 years ago. So there are quite a few voices around. It's not as if it's an unwritten landscape. It's people like... Vikram Seth, Salman Rushdie, Hanif Qureshi, Kazushi Guru, Arundhati Roy, Zadie Smith, Monica Lee, V.S. Naipaul, and. So there are voices, but you felt the need to collect voices. What is behind the book? How did it start?
Well, I mean, just going back to that list, the one that sticks out in that list is Zadie Smith, because she's of my generation. But you're talking about like an old guard of authors, and... there was a period after those authors where, you know, we all pretended that we weren't post-colonial, that we were post-colonial, and
You're not?
Well, no, I don't think so. Well, you know, twice a year the Queen hands out Order of the British Empire style awards, you know.
Okay.
But the book started in a bunch of different places. I was sitting on a diversity panel. We were talking about the lack of diversity in publishing, and I was saying something, and then I had this flashback to 5 years before that moment, saying exactly the same thing at a diversity panel, and
nothing had changed.
And I remembered while I was on that diversity panel that first time. The year before that, I'd been to a networking event of lots and lots of people from BAME backgrounds who were writers and working in publishing. And everyone was really sort of, everyone felt like things were going to change. There were lots of like exciting things happening. And then a year later, we were at this diversity panel. And then 5 years later, I was saying the same things. And like lots of other people were saying the same things. And so that happened. And then not long after that, or around the same time, an interview that I'd done in The Guardian was published. And the interview was this lovely journalist had asked five or six writers for their writing tips. Not very controversial, right? Some writing tips. So we all provided our writing tips, and my thing had been about how, you know, you have to, like, tips for knowing when something is finished. It was a completely uncontroversial piece, but one of the first comments in, and I know you shouldn't read the comments on The Guardian or any site, but I do, because sometimes you kind of have to know who you're fighting against, right? It turns out all the time we ignored the comments on The Guardian, it was breeding this new generation of neo-fascists. So one of the comments was from quite a prominent YA author who questioned why myself and all these other people had been interviewed for our writing tips. And they said, oh, well, these guys aren't even well known. Well, I suppose because they're all Asian, they probably all just know the journalist. And I hadn't actually noticed that we were all Asian because, you know, it's quite normal for me to be surrounded by lots of people who are like from a similar background. But this guy had obviously noticed. And I just felt exhausted in that moment. I thought, I'm so sick of having to justify my place at the table. I'm so sick of having to do things, not being able to do things on merit. Every time I have an opportunity, it's because of tokenism, or it's because of diversity box ticking, or it's because I'm mates with someone. How exhausting to never just like write something that's amazing and people praise it for it being amazing, regardless of and all that other stuff around it. And then I read two books. I read Citizen by, I was talking about this earlier, I read Citizen by Claudia Rankine and Between the World and Me by Ta-Nehisi Coates. And I loved those books. I thought they were really amazing pieces of work. And I really wanted to read like a UK equivalent, and there wasn't one. And when I was talking to my friend Musa Okwonga, who's in the collection, on Twitter about this, he reminded me of the Chinua Achebe quote, if you don't like someone's story, write your own. And so I thought, well,
you better get to work.
I better get to work. Because the thing with the lack of diversity in publishing, as we were talking in a previous session, I don't want to sort of over-repeat myself, is that there's loads of talent out there. We've established that. There's not very much of that talent is getting published. We've established that. And what tends to happen is people blame other parts of the industry. And I thought, well, actually, wouldn't it be great if we all just took ownership of the bit that we can do to help solve this thing that's going on? And what can I do? What can I do instead of just moan on Twitter? And so I thought, well, why don't I just put this collection together? I'd met the editor of this publisher called Unbound, which does publishes through crowdfunding. And I thought, well, why don't I just chat to her? It can happen quite quickly. And one of the amazing things about that book, this book, The Good Immigrant, and the fact that it was crowdfunded in 3 days before a word of the book was even written, was that it very quickly dispelled the myth that there isn't a readership for these types of books, because like 600 people paid to read a book written by these voices before a word of it was written. And I think that is a really important...
Was that the reason why you did choose crowdfunding?
Sorry?
Was that the reason why you did choose it, the crowdfunding method?
I chose it to kind of make a political point that there is a readership out there. Look, these guys want these books. And I chose it because...
J.K. Rowling helped.
Yeah, she did help. And that was amazing. That happened completely organically. And the other thing about the crowdfunding was that, you know, once the book was crowdfunded, all we had to do was write it, and then it could come out. I didn't have to spend months putting together a 50-page proposal and then have my agent then submit it to lots and lots of publishers and then wait, and then one publisher says yes, and then the months are slipping away, and we still haven't got any closer to showcasing some amazing writing, which is what I wanted to do.
The magazine Foreign Policy selected you as one of the most important, influential 100 global thinkers.
I know, ridiculous, right?
They did. Do you know why?
Well, I can tell you why the alt-right thought it was. They thought it was because I was a chubby samosa who hated white people, which is what was said about me on the internet after that happened. And to that person, if you're watching on this live stream is... what I would say is, a chubby samosa is a good samosa. You do not want a thin samosa. that was just utterly bonkers. I like, really unexpected. And I think, you know, I we were talking about this in the earlier session. Like, I think a lot of us who do all this advocacy work for increased diversity in publishing, like, ultimately, what we'd rather be doing is writing, I think. But, you know, we feel this need to do it, and we also feel like we can use our platforms in a positive way, and that's better than ignoring an issue that we all know, and, like, we will have all suffered from at some point. And just because you get in the door doesn't mean you then stop fighting for other people to come through. And so, being recognised like that, to show that, like, my Twitter rants and this book had, like, a global impact was really, really amazing.
The title, The Good Immigrant. Do you strive to be a good immigrant?
Well, I would debate whether anyone should strive to be a good immigrant. And, I think that the rules that are imposed on people who move are completely arbitrary. I don't necessarily think that. I don't think that we should hold people like immigrants and refugees to account for a set of rules that we don't hold ourselves account to. So, like, if we all think we're all good citizens, then, you know, maybe we can then debate what a good immigrant and a bad immigrant is. And also, I think the whole notion of it is really. It's really disgusting.
When do you become a good immigrant?
Sorry?
When do you become a good immigrant?
The moment you get past border control. I think I don't know. I really don't think it's like, because there is a lot of conversation about this idea of the good immigrant and the bad immigrant and what's happening in the UK, where Theresa May is sort of, on the one hand, planning to curb freedom of movement for European migrants and people from other parts of the world that aren't America and Australia. So America and Australia, they're the good kind of immigrant. We like them, but we don't like these guys. And when you're sort of pitting people in as, like, bartering chips, it seems, for good trade deals and sort of putting them into, like, a hierarchy of good and bad, I think that's really offensive.
Yeah. The two questions actually I would like to follow up with. One is, how do you select the writers? How did you select the writers? And what did you send them? What kind of theme or question did you send them?
How did I select them? I asked a lot of people who I knew and people who I followed on Twitter and people who I really liked to read online. And a lot, you know, a bunch of people who hadn't necessarily had books out.
But most of them weren't immigrants in the strict sense of the word. They were born in England.
Well, no, I mean, and this is the thing about the fallacy of that whole term. Like, we're all, like, a lot of us are proud children of immigrants. Mm-hmm. You know, there are some people who are, but you know, the title is meant to be subversive and it's meant to be provocative. There were a bunch of writers who I really, really loved reading from, and I thought you should all have literary agents and you should all be working on your books and know that they're going to get published. And if you need something that's traditionally published in a book, which sometimes does help, then here is my offer. Do you want to be in the book? And so some people didn't have time. Some people didn't want to do it for whatever reasons. And some people felt like writing a personal essay or a non-fiction essay was the opposite of what interested them about writing, which I thought, is fair enough. And my brief to them was, I want you to tell me a story. Right. It doesn't have to be about race and immigration in the UK. It doesn't have to be political. I just want you to tell me a story.
Did you decline essays?
We worked on ideas. I didn't decline any essays. My job was basically to give people a platform and then get out of their way, because I really wanted to ensure that whatever they submitted was their story and their voice. And the worst thing I could do would be to try and mitigate that too much. And it was really important for me that this book wasn't a political manifesto. It was 21 writers. Well, it was 20 writers, and then at the last minute, I thought, I'm going to slip one of my essays in myself, and I shall open the thing. Because I'm arrogant. No, I'm not. I'm a fat samosa, as we learned earlier. Because I think so much whenever you write about race or you write about politics, especially when you're from a marginalised background, it becomes very easy for people to consider you the spokesperson for that race or for that marginalised group. And we're not spokespeople for all of us. That strips all of us of any nuance. And some of the stories disagree with each other. Some of the stories come at the same topic, but with different reference points. Some of the stories, one story like really celebrates something and another story tries to tear it down. And I think that's really important, that it is a book that is kind of, these voices are, these voices aren't all, sitting around together going, what do you think about this? Oh, I think about it too. Okay, like, that becomes the party line. And that was really important to me.
I said in my introduction that the book appeared before the Brexit votum. Would Brexit have changed the book?
I think it would have. I think one of the so when I started putting the book together, it was very much a project designed to bring more diverse writers of colour into publishing. And then as we neared the referendum, it then gained this sort of political legitimacy because advanced copies were out in the world and people were reading it. And then,
so it became a very political book.
Yeah, and then the title, obviously, since the referendum or in the run-up to the referendum, there's been lots of stuff around hate crimes against people from Eastern European communities. And I think, had I done it as a political book, I probably would have tried to include more communities. But because the book was much more about showcasing writers of colour, when I was
the biggest community, foreign community, is the Polish immigrants.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying. Like, I think it potentially could have been a different book. And I think what's interesting, I think one of the criticisms levelled at the book has been, well, why isn't there this community in there, and why isn't there this community in there? And I always think, I agree with you, but at the same time, why weren't you asking for these voices before this book came out? Why is it that you're trying to derail what this book is trying to do by telling us what's missing from it, because it's not a political book, but it is. Yeah. Do you know what I mean?
Like, yes, of course.
Yeah. Mm. So it's been a really interesting journey, and the thing is, it has surpassed our expectations at every point. I thought it would come out and it would be a good thing for some of the writers to be able to send to agents and go, look at this, would you be interested in representing me? But then, we didn't count for J.K. Rowling or the award or for Brexit even, yeah. or any of it. And it's been amazing. And I think
top seller at Amazon.
Yeah.
There's so many things I want to ask you, and I'll probably get mixed up. One of them is, why are so many essays from literary people and people of the media? It says the good. I forgot the mic. There's so many contributors are working in the media or in the entertainment industry. Why is that? Is that because of your personal selection, or is it? Why is it?
As I said, like I think it's as the editor, your tastes are subjective, and. Okay. Because the book was about trying to provide a platform for writers who were doing things and kind of needed a push up.
So you're thinking of sequel, The Better Immigrant.
This is being live streamed, isn't it? So I can't.
Be careful.
But so basically, I'm doing. It's announced on the 7th of February. I'm doing another essay book with Unbound, and it's not with writers of colour, but it's working with another group to do with an issue that's very, very close to my heart. And let's just say my day job when I'm not a writer is I'm a youth worker, so I think we can do some maths and work out what this book will be. And it will be like a very broad book written by young people. Oh, I've just said it now. I'm doing a book of essays by under 24-year-olds about the state of... the nation. So I work with young people. I edit a magazine called Rife in Bristol, where I'm from. And what we do is we pay young people in 6-month paid internships to come and work for us and develop their voices and build their confidence and work on online content. And I mentor them for 6 months and I help them to steer their way into the creative industries. And the project is one of the best things I've ever done. I love it. It's like my favourite job that I've ever had. And one of the things that has been amazing has been working with lots and lots of young people, because they really challenge you as a writer. You know, they really show you new ways of communication, or the amount of content that they're sending me, and I'm sort of that's subverting what I think makes, say, a good essay or a good article. It has been great, and I've been so inspired by these guys. And one of the things, because it's quite a political magazine, because this generation in the UK is very politicised, and one of the things that has politicised them is that they didn't vote for this Conservative government, they didn't vote for Brexit. Scottish young people wanted independence, and all these decisions have been made by people outside of their demographic. And so, but they will be living with the consequences of these actions. They will be living with the consequences of Theresa May's like immigration policy and like the trade things and what it's going to do to our economy. And so I thought, why don't we just do an essay book where we collate these stories and we talk, we get young people to talk about what life looks like for them now.
Great idea.
Yeah, and that won't be just writers of colour. It'll be, all young people. And we're trying to get as wide, cast as wide a net as possible. And so we will be looking for, like, someone who's, quite conservative and, people who are from different marginalised groups. And I think it'll be really interesting. I'm very excited about it.
Got a title yet for that book?
Yes.
Life.
I have to hold one thing back for this special massive press announcement that I've completely just blown by talking about it on the internet. Sorry, Watershed. They said they would watch the thing, so that's why I'm apologising now.
The Good Immigrant should be an uncomfortable read, you said somewhere in an interview. What was uncomfortable for you in the book?
It really challenged me. It told me some stories that I'd never experienced or come across. It told me about communities I had no knowledge of. It played with, like, it made me question my unconscious bias. It challenged me in lots and lots of ways, and I really loved that it did. I think if it had just been perfectly within my Oh, I suppose it was in my echo chamber, but like, if it had been perfectly everything, I'd go, yeah, man, yeah, definitely. And it was just signal boosting opinions that I already had. I don't think it would have been as successful a book.
One thing that really fascinates me is nearly all of the contributors describe the moment when you meet someone and then where you're from.
No, where are you really from?
Yeah, that's the second question. Yeah. You say London, I said, no, where are you really from? I mean, really from. And I was thinking, how does this influence your notion of home? In my mind, I have Seamus Heaney, who has this farm in Northern Ireland, and said, this is the center of my world, this is Omphalos, and the navel of the world. My roots could go deep, deep down for many, many generations. In that same inspiring sense, do you have that feeling of I'm at home in Britain? Or is home a lot more for you? Or is home what Salman Rushdie once said, immigrants have homes in their mind more than in geography? And I also think of Ernst Bloch, who said home is something you aspire for but rarely achieve.
Home for me is my mum's kitchen. It was really amazing hearing Malaika talk about kitchens earlier, because I definitely get that sense. And you know, my mum's kitchen is a kitchen that doesn't exist anymore, so I've kind of felt quite unrooted. Was it the 80s or the 90s? There was this politician called Norman Tebbit, and he had a Britishness test, and it was basically around which cricket team did you support? Did you support the England cricket team because you're born here? From my dad's perspective, or my perspective, like supporting the India cricket team was always just a nice way of throwing back to my heritage. And I think the crapness of that test has filtered through various Conservative governments right through to what they see as British values at the moment. So there's been a lot of talk in schools over the last few years about British values. And the British values I'm paraphrasing, but they're about tolerance and multitudes, like a multitude of voices. And the thing about British values is like that they are quite vague. And I've never felt more British in a weird way than when I was campaigning alongside lots of people for us to remain in the EU in a weird way, because it felt like that relationship was so much more important to my sense of Britishness than sort of small town Englishness in a strange way, and I think the important thing about that realization that I am British, I think it helps you to critique something with a bit more love and care and passion. And so whenever I'm online sort of pointing out things that I don't like in the country, and Twitter eggs tell me to go home, I always think, Harrow, yeah? I'll go home to Harrow. Because that's, you know, that sense of home, you know, I've been thinking about it a lot, you know, go back to where you come from, go back to home. And I'm a Londoner who moved to Bristol, and so I would really like to move back to London, because I feel like I identify with being a Londoner more than I necessarily identify with certain aspects of my cultural heritage in a weird way. I feel like I was formed in a city. I need to be in a city. That was a really rubbish abstract answer that went all over the place, but
I looked it up. In the week after the Brexit vote, hate crimes had arisen 58% compared to the same period in the year before. 58% after the Brexit vote, I got quite a few mails from writer friends who were thinking about emigrating. So this is enough now. Were you tempted? Your friend what's his name?
Musa Okwonga. Yeah, he lives here.
He shuffled off to Germany, I think he said.
Mm. 20 minutes after the Brexit vote came in, someone online threatened to set me on fire, which I it's quite a violent thing to do. One of the things I did do was I'm third generation Indian. So my grandparents grew up in India. My parents didn't grow up in India. And I have kids, and I registered for a thing called an OCI card, which allows you to go to India and have like some citizen rights. And the reason I did that was because you're allowed to apply for one if your parents or your grandparents are born in India. And so if I don't do it now, then if my daughter ever wants to go to India, then she has that option. I mean, she can go as a tourist, but you know, if she ever wanted to go and work or what have you. So I have thought about it. But then I think I'd rather stay and fight.
Mm. You have a little daughter?
I do.
Yeah. There's a quote Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie wrote, "When I began to write at about the age of 7, stories that my poor mother was obligated to read, I wrote exactly the kinds of stories I was reading. All my characters were white and blue-eyed. They played in the snow, they ate apples, and they talked a lot about the weather, how lovely it was that the sun had come out. Now, this, despite the fact that I lived in Nigeria, I'd never been outside Nigeria. What do you do to change that for your daughter?"
So I've written about this a little bit, about curating picture books for my daughter that have positive representations of BAME, people of colour, and also people with disabilities and I don't know if this is the right term, non-traditional families, like, so with
And do you two remember the picture books? Do you remember the time when your daughter recognised herself in the picture book as different from white people?
Yeah.
How old was she?
Probably about one and a half, and she would...
So very, very early on.
Yeah, there's one book we had, it's called Fun at the Shops. A dad takes his daughter shopping, they buy some green apples, they buy some bread, she picks out a tasty treat for herself. I've read this book a lot, I could probably recite it to you. And the dad and the daughter in the book wear yellow macs, and they're both brown, and my daughter and I have matching yellow macs because we're adorable. And we would always say daddy and her, you know. And there was one day when she was reading the book to herself, and she was just saying to herself, that's sunny, and that moment was really powerful for me, to see someone see themselves reflected back in a book. Mm. Because my daughter, and it's really powerful, and you know, books are aspirational. Books are, you know, books that we read when we're kids, they give us role models or things we can aspire to be. So, you know, the kid who is an astronaut while his parents are asleep, or the kid who has wonderful adventures with their dog, or the kid who lives in a house with like an elephant, They play with your imagination, and so if you see yourself reflected back, then you know, you can see yourself as an astronaut, or you can see yourself in a house with an elephant, or what have you, like all these really, really powerful things. I thought a lot about the reaction to the Ghostbusters film that came out last year.
Oh yeah, the one
where they'd recast it as with an all female cast, and men just could not take it, and it was mostly cis straight white men, 18 to 40, who'd watched the film as kids or what have you, like basically the most overrepresented in like in the arts, and they just couldn't deal with the thought that women could be Ghostbusters, and I thought that was very indicative of these problems that we face, is where when people are overrepresented, they see themselves as the norm, they see their story as the normal, and they see all the other stories as the other. And so a film where a bunch of women fight ghosts is seen as the other, but a film where a bunch of men yeah. fight ghosts is seen as the norm. And I just think that is a really strange thing for these people to be thinking.
Another quote from Bernardine Evaristo's Lara. Lara, hopping off the 161 from Woolwich, only child of discernible color, did not notice her difference camouflaged by her uniform and the nattering swarm of pink-flushed, off-white, horny girlies. Do you remember a time when you were white?
Wow. I feel like I'm in a therapy session.
Because 1.5 years is very, very early, as far as I know from literature, of course, only. There are moments in life when people fairly late realize I'm not part of what's normal. I'm different. I'm other.
I think it was drilled into me quite early on because of the way my family is and also where I went to school. And I think, I don't know. I don't feel like I ever, I don't think I ever did feel, I don't know. We're about to have an awkward silence where I delve into my memories. That's probably not very entertaining for anyone to watch.
Do you remember a time when you wanted to be white?
Yes. Yeah, I can remember that. I can definitely remember that. I don't know why I leapt at that. Yes! Now! No. You know, when you're a teenager and you want to ask out girls and the girls don't want to go out with you, and then you start to think about, you start to sort of like wonder, like you have this ideal in your head of like what would make the girl go out with you. And I think I always thought if I was like a dashing, tall, blonde, chiseled, archetypal jock, Zach Morris basically from Saved by the Bell, then... that maybe, yeah, so like I feel like in those times, in those weak times where I've sort of felt different, yeah.
Any more questions from the audience while we're at it?
Please.
You speak up quite a lot. You love the title.
Can you repeat the question?
Oh, okay. Waiting for the mic.
Awkward silence.
Tell us something about the new novel. I'm very curious.
It is a very strange novel. It's I've spent years trying to write that novel. It's a novel that I wrote my first novel instead of writing that novel. I wrote my second novel instead of writing that novel. I wrote a third novel very easily, not long after my second novel came out. That I put in a drawer because I thought that was too easy. That, I know it sounds arrogant, that was too easy. But that it just felt like I wasn't challenging myself with that novel, and I was just distracting myself from writing this one, yeah. Which I always wanted to, I wanted to tell the story of immigration through small events in a family's life, and so it's told across four different decades across different parts of the UK, and it plays with like commedia dell'arte, so you know the structures of commedia dell'arte where you have like a matriarch, a patriarch, a craftsman, and a clown, and so I wanted to have those archetypes all sort of coming together, and it plays with notions of destiny as well. It basically, I'm in the middle of editing it, so I don't feel like I know how to talk about it yet in that sort of really pithy, hey, it's about this way. It all sort of feels like a jumble in my head.
Based on your family?
No. There are moments that are similar to moments my family went through, and like some significant details that are significant to my family, but it's... And it is very personal, but it's not about my family. I'm hoping at some point someone will get the low-key Bollywood reference I put into the title of the novel, which always makes me happy, but no one's picked up on it yet.
Okay. The mic has arrived.
Take two. You speak out quite a lot. You advocate. You wore a jumper that's a token to an interview. Do you ever feel like you have to decide... or do you ever feel like you need to compromise what you, as in stop what you're about to say or watch what you're about to say or write, just so you can get a commission or be published or, you know, have people not be pissed off at you, I guess, to get work?
I think the ship has probably sailed on people being pissed off with me moaning about diversity. There came a point in the last year where I kind of felt like there are so many people like doing the work. It's just that at that point, my voice was maybe the loudest, and I wanted to ensure that it didn't just look like it was me being like this lone wolf going diversity, diversity, diversity. And so I kind of like not took a step back, but just sort of moaned less on Twitter. I don't think I've compromised myself. I don't think I have. I think, like, the success of the book has kind of spoken to like the work, because ultimately, like, we say all these things and they are uncomfortable truths and they are truths, but ultimately in the world of books, it's about the books. And so, like, I think I've backed up all like the lobbying I've done with a successful book. That book has been this sort of wonderful community for these writers to kind of like carry on their amazing careers. And I think that's been the most important bit. Like, I think if the book had tanked, then maybe I would have gone like backed into a bush quietly or something.
Any more questions?
Hi, thanks for the reading, and I really love this part about language being important, and I think right now it's super important, and one thing that I can't speak to that as a person of color, but as a woman I can, and the recent women's marches in the U.S., which is my context, I heard a lot of people say, where's your sense of humor, you know? There were jokes like, you know, I like watching women walk from behind, and I was told that I needed to have a sense of humor, and you mentioned this as well in the essay. And I wonder how you respond to people who tell you to have a sense of humor, to lighten up. How do you deal with that?
I guess in those situations, I defer to Teju Cole's Twitter bio. Does everyone know Teju Cole, the amazing writer? His Twitter bio is we who. It just says we who. And I think that's a really important question to ask. Who's laughing? Who's telling the joke? Who's the butt of the joke? These sort of conversations that are happening about humour and about satire and at what point jokes are offensive. And I think it's important to recognise that satire punches up, it never punches down. And so I think unsuccessful satire or sort of calls for people to lighten up, they derail. So I would just ask that person who's finding it funny and who's not finding it funny. You know, that's the thing that they need to interrogate, and it's not your responsibility to interrogate it for them.
And it always depends on who is saying what. I mean, it's the voice. I remember reading about Kitab in your Meat Space novel. Mm. Kitab has a doppelganger. And the first time he meets his doppelganger from India, he looks at him and says, "You're looking disappointingly Indian."
Yeah.
It's something only an Indian man could have said.
Yeah, and I wanted to play with the sort of the notion of when you're a child of the diaspora, you end up building this sort of internalized sort of feelings towards people from where you're from, and well, not all of you, but like some people do, and I wanted to play with that notion of like what that even means and what that dynamic is doing. And so it is very much about sort of, yeah, acknowledging the sort of the internalized racism that Kitab has in that moment.
It reminded me also of the comedian Chris Rock, who had this rap on who was more racist, the black or the white. And it's again something only he as a black person could say.
Well, I think context is important in humor. And you know, like, I think it's important to sort of to recognize who's telling the joke and who's the butt of the joke. Yeah, as I was saying before.
There was another question. I can't see anything.
There's one just there.
Okay.
You said you hadn't rejected any of the contributions that came. This is a very open and welcoming thing. How much actual editing did you have to do? Do you have to call people and say, this isn't working, or wouldn't it be a good idea if?
So I worked with them to kind of help them shape their stories. And I always worked with them. I never sort of got stuff in and then just like rewrote it all and sent it back. And then, you know, some people needed a bit more time than others, and I think so much of it was just about investing time in helping the writers to get it right. And you know, the book was actually late being delivered because, you know, I just wanted to ensure that the writers took their time. And so it was a lot of Skype conversations and suggestions and questions. I always find in those moments, it's just good to ask lots of questions, because I think editorial notes are often a steer. They're not necessarily an edict. Change this, you know, as the writer, you know best, and if you're confident enough in your abilities, you know when to push back, and you know when to fight for something, and you know when the question being asked is the right one, because maybe you haven't executed that bit of the text properly, or maybe it needs looking at, or maybe it's not saying what you need it to say. So in your head, it's fine, but on the page, it's not.
Any more questions?
Is this working? Yeah. I was just wondering if you could talk a bit about diversity in audiences as well, because I found it interesting this morning you were saying that you had this reading of The Good Immigrants and there was a room full of young people of colour. And Bernadine was saying yesterday, you know, it's only middle-aged women who buy fiction. And my suspicion is that there's maybe a bit of a self-fulfilling prophecy in that books are kind of marketed to middle-aged women, mostly kind of white middle-class middle-aged women. And that is that the other side of this equation of diverse voices, yes, getting more people in the industry, but also maybe opening it up to, and how, you know, is that something that could in some way be acted on, or will it just happen organically if those diverse voices are brought in?
Yeah, so I think the thing that links those two things together was the moment in Irenison's session where she said, that a bit of feedback that she'd received was they didn't know how to market it. And that's really key. You kind of, there are audiences out there, and if you don't know how to market a book, then you need to find someone who to a certain audience. You find someone who markets a book to a certain audience. I think one of the things that it's been quite interesting about audiences. I think for the longest time, there was this assumption that there was this mass mainstream audience out there. And maybe in publishing's case, it was the middle-aged woman that Bernadine was talking about. Maybe that was the mass market that people aimed everything at. But I think what's interesting now is like there are multiple audiences out there, and you kind of have to tailor your approach to kind of to reach those audiences and to engage with those audiences. It's not, I don't think it's a question of saying, here's a book, hope you like it. So the thing with the Good Immigrant was that it sort of felt like for a lot of young people, a lot of students, a lot of people in their 20s, it was the first time that they'd kind of seen a generation of writers write about stuff that they felt was going on in their lives. And so they really supported the book, and that was a really amazing thing to see. And I think when you're like part of a marginalized community, when that one thing hits, or when that one thing comes out, you all know about it and you all support it. And and it was hard to kind of ignore. And I think a lot of that was to do with how we use social media and word of mouth as well. So I think having more diverse people in publicity teams and in sales and marketing teams who acknowledge that there are different ways to attract different communities will be the way to expand our reading audiences, because people are out there. They're just waiting for the right book to be shown to them.
There's one question in the very back.
I just want to know about the new novel and the title, because you never mentioned the title. You only indicated that there is an obscure Bollywood reference, and of course that's piqued everybody's interest. So you have to now come clean about the title.
The title is The One Who Wrote Destiny, which is a rough translation of a very famous Bollywood song called Naseeb. The running thread throughout the novel is about notions of destiny and fate, and how much of our lives are predetermined either by patterns that exist in our families or by an actual figure called destiny who has written everything down that you will experience, or we have free will. That's where the title came from. It was originally called A Man Without a Donkey. Because there's a Kenyan proverb, a man without a donkey is a donkey, and I really love that proverb. But then I changed it for various reasons.
For this afternoon, I dug out his division's English report, and your teacher wrote, his best writing is when he relies on his own judgment and finds his own voice. You found it?
Let me tell you about that teacher, man. That teacher changed my life.
Did he?
Mr. Roseblade, yeah. So he was the only good teacher at the school that I really hated. And
I hated my English teacher. Yes.
And he made us study lots of really interesting things, and he just increased my palette of things that I read. And one of the most amazing moments for me as a writer was in the signing queue at Cheltenham Festival in October. He was there, and he'd come to Cheltenham. He'd moved to Cheltenham, and he'd come to see me. And as soon as I saw him, I knew exactly who he was, and we had a really nice chat. He added me on WhatsApp. We chat every now and then, and I still feel weird about meeting up with him because I have really, really, really difficult feelings about that school. But I'm really glad that he was right.
Yeah,
he was right.
A writer who's found his voice. Thank you very much.
Thank you to you, and to the British Council as well.